When we think about resistance to ALK TKIs, we think about several types of resistance. So there is primary resistance. We find that very rarely, fortunately. So the vast majority of patients who are ALK fusion positive, especially if they've been tested appropriately with a good test and a good evaluation. The primary resistance is quite rare, meaning that there's no clinical benefit. It sometimes occurs. I also don't think that we're able to predict which patients are likely to fail up front. As I mentioned, these patients are quite rare. One situation where we sometimes see primary resistance is in the rare situation of dual oncogene driver. So that's a situation where the patient may have an ALK gene rearrangement, but also an EGFR or KRAS mutation. Fortunately, that's quite rare. And I think for patients who have dual oncogene mutations, we should proceed with caution and close surveillance if we're going to choose one or the other tyrosine kinase inhibitor to treat those patients with, because I think they're probably the most likely to have primary resistance and early failure of these drugs. In terms of secondary resistance for ALK-positive disease, we've learned a lot over the last decade in terms of how patients become resistant. And although there are subtle variations for different drugs in terms of what types of resistance emerges, I think we can group these into two general patterns. Patients become resistant via secondary kinase domain mutations in ALK. So for example, the gatekeeper mutation at L1196M or the solvent front mutation at G1202R. Those are very common mutations that we might observe with a number of different ALK inhibitors. So those are the patients, I think, that are most likely to benefit from switching to a next generation ALK inhibitor or a different ALK inhibitor because they've maintained the ALK dependence in their cancer cells. They've just, their cancer cells have figured out a way to become resistant to a particular drug. The second way in which patients become resistant to ALK inhibitors is through a mechanism called bypass signaling, and that's very different. So in this case, patients' cancer cells often activate other pathways that no longer would be responsive to an ALK inhibitor. Those are both more difficult to detect by modern testing methods, even by NGS, and often more difficult to treat as well. It might involve switching to a completely different class of drugs or having to combine drugs, and we don't really have any FDA-approved options for patients, for example, who may develop MET as a mechanism of resistance to alectinib. We may be able to detect it in some cases, but currently there are no FDA-approved options. In those situations, so for example, if a patient is resistant to alectinib and we find evidence of MET gene amplification, one potential option is to switch them back to crizotinib or to crizotinib for the first time, because crizotinib not only inhibits the ALK tyrosine kinase, but also the MET tyrosine kinase. That's not necessarily an approved use, but an option for our patients. And so I think that's still an emerging area of research to better understand not only how to diagnose patients with bypass signaling, but then how best to treat them. Patients who are ALK positive and treated with TKIs, we can often understand how their cancer cells become resistant via biopsy of a progressing lesion. So we can do a biopsy of a lung metastasis that's growing or a liver metastasis that's growing and do next generation sequencing to understand if their tumors have acquired a secondary mutation in the ALK kinase domain. That may help us choose the next ALK inhibitor. We know from many years of both clinical data and laboratory data that we can often predict sensitivity and resistance to different drugs based on the type of resistance mutation that occurs. So for example, alectinib can become resistant via an I1171 mutation that then may be responsive to ceritinib. And crizotinib, you may have a gatekeeper mutation, L1196M, that generates resistance to crizotinib, but then becomes sensitive to many of the next generation inhibitors, including ceritinib, alectinib, and brigatinib. We know that if you acquire a G1202R mutation in ALK, that perhaps the best drug is lorlatinib, a newer generation drug, but also brigatinib may have some activity in that setting too. So doing a serial biopsies may help us understand that. What's really revolutionized the way we track disease progression in ALK-positive patients are liquid biopsies or ctDNA analysis. Obviously, it's far less invasive than a tumor biopsy, lower risk because we're just drawing blood, which we're often doing on our patients anyways, often with very short turnaround times of a week or so. So we can very easily monitor how the disease is progressing at multiple time points. And I think that's an important point. If patients have received multiple prior ALK TKIs, I think sometimes it can be hard to interpret resistance if you haven't been tracking it all along. Now, having said all of this, although ctDNA and liquid biopsy is a very useful way to track disease progression and perhaps select next therapies, I want to emphasize that it's not FDA approved, and it's not necessary for any of these drugs to do that. I think one of the very important trials that is just activated is the ALK Master Protocol, and this will really help us understand whether it makes sense to choose our drugs based on the type of resistance that's observed. Initially, this is going to be done by both tumor biopsy and liquid biopsy, and will help us understand how well those two types of monitoring correlate, and ultimately will tell us if it makes clinical sense to pick our drugs based on the type of resistance that we're observing in the tumor, whether that's done by tumor testing or liquid biopsy.